I was going to try and explain a bit about a result called van der Werden's theorem, which is one of the fundamental results of Ramsey theory, which is an area that I'm very interested in. Van der Werden's theorem is about colouring the positive integers. So you take the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on, and to each one you assign a colour. And the idea is that you only have finitely many colours to use. However you do it, it's possible to find an arithmetic progression. That is a set of integers like 5, 9, 13, 17, 21, where the step between each one and the next is the same, however long you want. Okay, so let's imagine a game with the following rules. We start with two numbers, let's say 28 and 13. And I say to you, you've got 13 colours to use, and I want you to try and colour the positive integers, that is, assign one of these 13 colours to each positive integer, in such a way that I can't find an arithmetic progression of length 28 that only uses one colour. However you choose your colouring with 13 colours, van der Werden's theorem says I'm always going to win that game. I'm always going to be able to find somewhere an arithmetic progression of length 28 that only uses one colour.
And it's your choice what the gap of that progression is.
Yeah, I get to choose. Sometimes it's called the common difference. Sometimes it's called the step of the arithmetic progression. So, yes, I can't tell you in advance what the step will be. That will depend on how you choose to do the colouring. Actually, I can explain that straight away. So supposing, in addition, I needed to find a progression where the step was 3.
So 28 numbers, all 3 apart.
Yeah, you could easily stop that, even with just two colours. You could colour red, 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 blue, 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 red, 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 blue, 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 and then each number would have a different colour from the number 3 on. So I couldn't even find an arithmetic progression of length 2 with just one colour, if we insisted that the step was 3. So for me to have a winning strategy, I have to be allowed to choose the step. But if I am allowed to choose the step, then I can win the game. Well, I thought I might start with the very, very simplest case, which is, what happens if you just want to find an arithmetic progression of length 2? So if you think about that for a second, you realize that is actually extremely easy. Let's suppose we have two colors, red and blue. So without loss of generality, one is colored blue. Now, if I want to avoid an arithmetic progression of length 2 in one color, I'd better color 2 red. And now what about 3? If I color it blue, I have an arithmetic progression of length 2 and step 2. But if I'd coloured it red, I'd have had an arithmetic progression of length 2 and step 1. So that's not a very hard problem. As soon as you've got two things of the same colour, so if the number of colours is 75, then as soon as you've coloured 76 numbers, then by the famous result known as the pigeonhole principle, there must be two that are the same colour. And having two of the same colour is the same as having an arithmetic progression of length 2. The first truly interesting case of van der Werden's theorem is something that I think it's not too hard to explain, but it's quite subtle, and the ideas that go into the proof of the whole theorem are already present in this special case. So the idea is actually to make use of this very simple case of progressions of length 2, and also to make use of the pigeonhole principle that I've just mentioned, and put them together in a clever way, and then you can get that if you have two colours, then I will be able to find a progression of length 3 that just uses one colour.
Okay, so I've got, there's two colours being used for the colouring in. You want to find a progression of 3, so 3 numbers that have a regular step.
A regular step, and either red, 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 or blue, blue, blue. So I'm going to show that it's impossible for you to avoid that situation if you colour enough numbers.
Okay.
So the way to prove this, let's take a block of 5 numbers. Now, what I'd like to do is focus on the first 3 numbers and how those are going to be coloured. Now, we know from what we just said that there will be 2 of the first 3 that have the same colour. So this is actually the same argument that I've just been talking about.
All 3 could be the same colour.
Yes, all 3. Yes. When I say 2, I mean at least 2 have to be the same colour. Yeah, that's an important point. So whatever happens, in the first 3, I have at least 2 that have the same colour. So let's just suppose it's this one here. I'll just represent it by a blob rather than writing a number. And this one here doesn't really matter. Now, if you're trying to avoid a progression of length 3, then once you've got those two that are the same colour, that's going to force the colour of one of the other ones. Because they were in the first 3, whichever one they, so to speak, point to has to be the opposite colour. So we've got something like that. Otherwise, I'd have had blue, blue, blue with a step of 2. And I would have been very happy because I would have won the game. And that wasn't the only possibility. Another possibility, it might have been that the first 2 were red. But in that case, we could have been absolutely sure that the third one was blue. So I'm not saying that this precise configuration has to happen, but something like this has to happen. Within the first five, you're going to have two that are the same color and take the same step and reach a third one that has the opposite color. And there's only a certain number of ways that you can do that. So now what we do is we divide the integers into blocks of five. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I'm not writing in the numbers, I'm putting dots instead. From back here, there's only a certain number of ways that we could get a configuration like this. I'm going to keep count while I do this. So it could be blue, blue, red, or it could be red, red, blue, or it could be blue, blue, red, or it could be red, red, blue, or it could be second and third one blue. So blue, blue, red, or red, red, blue. I've got up to six. So there's six different ways. So it's which one you leave out. That gives you three choices. And whether the two that go in the other two places are blue or red, that makes it up to six choices. At least one of these six configurations has to occur, however I color the first five things. So now what I'm going to do is look at these blocks. I know that each one has got one of six configurations like this. By the pigeonhole principle, again, if I color these blocks, as soon as I've colored more than six of them, two of them must have the same configuration of this kind.
They aren't necessarily identical, are they? But they have that killer configuration.
They do. Actually, if you wanted to, you could make them identical, and this is the way it's usually presented. So how many ways are there of coloring the first five? There are 32 ways of doing it. So I could, if I wanted to, fill up 33 blocks, and then I'd have two that actually were colored in precisely the same way.
Yep.
But I'll do it this way for today. It doesn't matter. So that is...
Because there are only six for what we really care about.
Right,
for that
exactly.
That killer moment.
And then the other ones can be sort of even just left uncolored, whatever. So let's just suppose that this block had a red, I'll draw it a different way now, red, red, blue, and this block here also had a red, red, blue. So we know that somewhere we're going to be able to find two. So we've got red, red, blue, and we have a red, red, blue. Let's take the block that is the same distance from this one as this one is from this one. So I go the same step. It doesn't matter, this one I've drawn it two away, but it could have been five away. Whatever happens, I just go the same step along. Now let's try to color this. So far this is sort of not exactly forced, but up to which one of these things I happen to choose, you're forced to have something like this. So once you've done that, let's just think how to color this. So this one here, well, I've got red, and then I jump up by 10 and I've got red, and so this one had better be blue, otherwise I've won the game. This one's red, so this one had better be blue as well. What about this one? That's blue. And that's blue, so that had better be red. So remember, this red here was a forced move.
Yeah.
But now let's have a look. The first one here, and I'll jump up by 12 to the second one here, and then by another 12 to the third one here. I've got red, red, red.
Yeah.
Victory. Although what I've drawn is a special case, you can see, I think, that if it had been that configuration and they'd been four apart instead of two apart, or it had been blue, blue, red, and they'd been even sort of nine apart, I could have the same strategy of looking at the one that was the same distance along and looking at what it had to be here and here and here, one would have ended. Actually, there were two reasons this had to be red. There was this blue, blue, red, and there was this blue, blue, red. But there's also the red, 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 which means that once it's been forced, then actually the game is lost for anyone who's trying to avoid a progression of length three.
This red, red, blue configuration is not the only configuration among our six killers, but all six of those killers have a similar property to that, a similar
right, reason. So maybe I could just actually illustrate one more example. So supposing it had not been red, red, blue like that, but it had just been first two blue, and the third one red. Supposing when I find two blocks that have the same configuration, the configuration that they share is blue, blue, red, then so somewhere along here I've also got blue, blue, red. So then over here, so that blue, blue forces a red, and this blue, blue forces a red, and then the red, red forces a blue, but then I've got that one,
yeah,
and that one, and that one.
Oh, the first, the second, and the third, yeah.
This is an argument sometimes known as the color focusing argument, because these two colors focus on that point and force it to be red if you're trying to win the game, but those two focus on and force it to be blue, and it can't be both red and blue.
You're telling me that with a lot more paper and a lot more pens, and a lot more time, this argument would work for 19 colors and a progression of 40 and things like that.
Yes. So if you want to do another case that's just a little bit bigger, maybe three colors and progression of length three or something, then it turns out to be not that much more complicated. I won't actually try to do it, but I'll just say that the pigeonhole principle is what enabled us to say, as long as you take enough blocks, you can find two that are colored in the same way, or actually, as we did it, two that contain the same little configuration of this kind. For a later version, you might need to have three things that are colored in exactly the same way that have the same step between them. But once you know van der Weerden's theorem for progressions of length three, instead of using the pigeonhole principle, you can use van der Weerden's theorem. So the idea is that once you've proved some cases of van der Weerden's theorem, then you can use those to prove later cases. Or, as mathematicians would say, the argument is an argument by inductions. What I've shown you is the first, not completely obvious, inductive step of an inductive argument. Ideal medium for explaining a maths result. Sometimes, you know, somebody will explain something in a talk using a board, and the ideas all seem very clear. And if you go back and look at the paper, which is the same argument, but presented in a less visual form using symbols and stuff, decoding what it says can be quite a difficult process.